What were the lessons we learned from the Galvan Valley face-off? How far we have been able to implement those lessons?
One of the lessons which we have learned is be prepared for any eventuality. And when dealing with the PLA, in any case, as armed forces, you don't trust anyone else other than yourself. So there's no trust. Even if we have flag meetings and we have five agreements which form the basis of our peace and tranquility, but the fact is that you got to trust your own capabilities, your own leadership, your own reactions, and that is what you trust, your own experience. And that is one lesson which we learned in Galvan. And like I said, everyone may talk about Galvan being, I think Galvan was a high point. It is because of Galvan that 1 year has been a peaceful year. We have had transgressions, really. We on a daily basis, I think we saw transgressions, about 450 transgressions every year, if I recollect earlier. So that is more than one a day. So it is not that transgressions didn't happen, transgressions happened. But if you look at the last 1 year post Galvan, we've had relative peace. They have not escalated. China has not escalated ever thereafter. Whatever they had come forward to implement, they are there, then they will go back. I'm sure they will go back because they cannot sustain. It is not sustainable to be there. But then we'll have to learn the right lessons in ensuring that we get good logistics. We'll have to learn lessons in improving our infrastructure, not only for defense and security, but also to integrate our people and their well-being who are in the border areas, provide them education, provide them health, provide them communication. Right? We'll have to ensure that we have digital signatures all along the line of actual control, which are not really there right now. We'll have to do a host lot of things. We'll have to empower our villagers, actually. We'll have to synergize our intelligence and surveillance and reconnaissance capabilities. So it's a long way forward. We've learned a lot of lessons, but we'll need the resources for that. What has happened is because of the LAC and because of COVID, our resources are limited. The armed forces are required to do more and more in less and less. So that there lies the challenge.
How has India approached Eastern Ladakh post-China to recalibrate its strategy?
I think what it has done is it has reviewed our strategy. It was being very aggressive in the month of last year, in the month of May, June. That aggression is now, it's latent. It is not there. It's not that disengagement in all places has not taken place. The three steps are disengagement, de-escalation and de-induction. So we are still a way off. But China's strategy is now one of just holding and one of face saving and not escalating at all. Because escalation control, I think, is very important for both sides. China is not here to wage a war with India. That's why. But that will only happen if we are prepared. If we're not prepared, then we'll fight. He'll wage a war at us. So if we are fully prepared, we are operationally ready, we are we demonstrate our will to face him, he will not wage a war. He doesn't want to pay the cost. He's looking at being a world leader, bipolar world with US. Why should he come and wage a war and degrade himself and his capabilities with a very strong, resolute India? So yeah. China has recalibrated that. It will keep using its military coalition, which it has done along the LAC. It is also, not in our areas, but in the neighborhood, he has been very proactive. In our neighborhood, he has got a debt trap. Philosophy. Pakistan, of course, is his all-weather friend. He has started interfering in Nepal, in Myanmar, in Bangladesh to an extent. He did not like Bangladesh, being part of the port, Sri Lanka, Colombo port, or Hambantota. So that's his way of containing India to where it is. Because India is the only country which can actually tilt the balance, right? In this bipolar world, in a emerging geopolitical world order, India will be the, I won't say balancing power, but India will be India. India is a global leader, a regional power. We should understand our rightful place in the community of nations and then balance our interests. We should not get involved in the balance of power game. There's a balance of power game between China and US, right? Russia on one side, Japan to another, India. So these are major players, Australia for that matter. So we'll have to balance our interests. And China has declared a strategy to contain India in many spheres. We should understand that China can resort to non-traditional security challenges. Like COVID is one of them. Cyber is another one. Economic, of course, our economy is growing. He needs us but we also need it. So it's mutual. So we do have still mutual, we share interest. But it has recalibrated its thing, and we have to have pressure points on him to deter him. And that, I think, comes both being very strong along the line of actual control and having capabilities to dominate and deter in the Indian-Ocean region.
Sir, what is the message that China intends to send across by holding military drills near LSE?
China believes in its three warfare strategy. The three warfare strategy is public opinion is a very major part of that information war, and that is what China is exactly doing. It's three warfare strategy: legal warfare, second one; psychological operations, the third one. So if you look at what China has done, whether it was in Doklam, it started three warfare strategy along the line of actual control. It's a three warfare strategy at play again. We understand three warfare strategies, but then we cannot intervene in the Chinese minds, because China, another close society. It does not give us the digital access which we have. So China can play on our minds by fake news, by truth decay, by saying that they're having military drills, they're doing technological advances. They can do all that. But in the end, we have to understand that the man on the ground is what matters. It's not that we can't. We also use technology. They're not the only ones. And in all these places, technology has got it's got a role to play, but it's got a limited role to play, because even the power packs don't work out there. These are altitudes of 5,000 meters, 4,800 meters. Nothing really works out other than the man. So China's psychological operations and its information war, public opinion war, is something we will have to be aware of. And that is where I request the media has got a very important role to play in this. You have to tell the public what is what and what is not. So if the public is aware of all this, so the media is one of our major, the Indian media, I think, is a major asset to us as a nation, as to the armed forces also, for that matter. And because we convey the right signals to our own people, and that also conveys the correct strategic signals to China. So that is where I think we'll have to understand the three warfare strategy and tell our people that what China is doing is military drills and all is part of a public warfare, and there's nothing to really, we are capable of dealing with it. It's not that I'm not saying we should not take it. We should factor it in, but we should not bother too much about it.
Do you think China's relationship with India relies on New Delhi's external environment? Is whatever that's happening on the borders due to India's proximity to the US?
Yes, definitely. I don't think China wants India to go into the US, part of the US lobby. But China has again miscalculated. Rather than by the military coercion it did, it is actually pushing us towards that. It's not that it's pushing us. It has to understand how the Indians work, how the Indians think, what the Indian concepts are, what the Indian philosophy is. But we are a very proud nation. We have strategic autonomy. We will be, we are not only with US, but we are part of so many multilateral arrangements. We are also part of BRICS, and we are the chairman of BRICS for this year. We are also part of the trilateral RIC, Russia, India, China. We are part of BIMSTEC, we are part of IPSA, so G7, G20, we are part of the D10, the Democracy of 10 Nations. So the China has to understand that we have a strategic autonomy which is very dear to us, and it is not that we get pushed towards the US, but yes, quad is there, and if China has, we can put pressure on China by quad, why not? We will do that. Even in the security, even in the Indian Ocean, if we don't have the capabilities right now to put full pressure on him, we will take the like-minded people. We'll bind to balance with the nations which have congruence and convergence of interests. So there's nothing new about it. We'll do that.
Is there a possibility of another Galwan-type incident happening along the border? And can an all-out war happen between the two neighboring countries? Are we prepared?
This is something which concerns us all. All Indians are concerned, the world is concerned. Galwan, I don't think will get repeated. It should not. But then when troops face each other in these high altitudes, there's always a possibility of a spiral. We have done very well. We have excellent drills and very good leaders who are on the ground controlling things. They have achieved top onwards, along with the others. So I don't visualize Galwan happening, because China, like I said earlier, China understood that Galwans are not going to pay dividends. Okay. He was prepared for many Galwans. That's my reading. He was prepared for many Galwans. But he realized that the cost for time will be higher and it will not pay dividends. So I that way the Galwan, but the spiral is always a possibility. So we should be prepared for spiral, and we prepare for contingency, all contingencies. So that is as far as Galwan is concerned. As far as all-out war is concerned, any war has to have political end state, political aims, and from there flows the military objectives. In our case, as far as India is concerned, war waging is not really an option for us. It is war prevention what we are looking at. We don't want to wage a war. We are a peace-loving nation. We have many other priorities. And as far as China is concerned, I do not think it's an interest to wage a war with India. It has got more to lose by waging a war with India than the returns which will, you know, accrue to it. But if we are not prepared for war, then we'll face a war. If we are fully prepared for war, deterrence and war prevention comes through preparation. And you have to be prepared and operationally ready to prevent wars. Armed forces are not meant to fight wars, actually. Armed forces are meant to ensure peace and security.